Ladies and gentlemen, the Secretary of Defense. Please be seated. Ladies and gentlemen, at this time, I would like to introduce Vice Admiral George Sterner, Commander, Naval Sea Systems Command.
Well, good morning, Secretary Cohen, Secretary Perry, Secretary Douglas, distinguished guests, the Sea Sparrow team, Captain Taggett. We're here this morning to recognize our NATO Sea Sparrow Project Office and their capability modernization team. This is a team of men and women who accepted the challenge to help create a government that works better and costs less. They took a 30-year-old system and revitalized it so that our Navy people will sail on ships that can defend themselves better than they could before. And they did three of my favorite things. They saved some government money, they saved some government time, and they produced a top-notch defense system for our sailors. By challenging the traditional ways that we design, build, and deliver weapon systems, the team improved Sea Sparrow's capability and will save over $140 million in the next couple of years. They had the foresight to make sure the system cost to our customers and our NATO partners will be significantly less to operate and maintain. We think of this as an extraordinary hammer award, and I should tell you that this is the 26th that our command has gotten. But it's going to benefit not just America, but our 12 nation product partners, including Australia, Belgium, Canada, Denmark, Germany, Greece, Italy, the Netherlands, Norway, Portugal, Spain, and Turkey. Captain Taggett, I'd like to extend to you my personal congratulations and to your fine team. And thanks for adding another one to our collection. Well done. It is now my special privilege, though, to introduce our host for this morning's ceremony. The Secretary, throughout his career of public service, has long championed the cause for a strong defense. As a senator, he was proponent for the very thing you see here today in streamlining the acquisition process, reducing costs, and was a drafter of the Federal Acquisition Reform Act. We are indeed lucky to have him at our helm. Ladies and gentlemen, please join me in welcoming the Honorable William S. Cohen, Secretary of Defense.
Admiral Sterner, thank you very much. And ladies and gentlemen, I'm here to recognize today the good work that a Department of Defense team has done to cut the costs and improve the effectiveness of the NATO Sea Sparrow surface missile program and system. Before I get to the award, I'd like to say a word about Iraq. We have an unusual array of television journalists who are here today and print journalists, and I'm sure that they are deeply interested in ways in which the Department of Defense is saving money, but I suspect they also have an interest in one or two current events. So let me just begin by saying that the United Nations has charged that Iraq is tampering with surveillance systems installed to monitor compliance with UN mandates, and we have no reason to question that assessment on the part of the United Nations. The evidence cited by Richard Butler, who is the head of the United Nations Special Commission, suggests that Iraq may be continuing programs to develop weapons of mass destruction. And Mr. Butler's letter underscores what this crisis really is about. Iraq is violating UN Security Council resolutions by blocking efforts to monitor whether it is continuing work on weapons of mass destruction. A UN team is now in Baghdad to insist on full compliance with the Security Council resolutions. They are not there to negotiate with Iraq under any circumstances. This is not a negotiable item. And so it's imperative that Iraq comply with UN mandates. I'd like to turn now to talk about why we are here, and then at the conclusion, unless there – well, I could entertain one or two questions initially, and then move on to the important matter that we have here today, Charlie.
Mr. Secretary, might I ask, Iraq has been warned repeatedly not to continue on making weapons of mass destruction. If it's found that they are doing that, will any further warning be given, or might a surprise military strike be launched?
I think sufficient warnings have been given to Iraq over the years that they must comply with UN sanctions. It's not a question of not having adequate warning. The task right now, however, is to persuade them to cease and desist from their obstruction. And that is the reason for the United Nations having sent this team to sit down and persuade, hopefully diplomatically, that Iraq must comply, that they cannot be successful in asking the U.S. Team members to depart or not be part of the inspections team. This is a United Nations effort. This is not a U.S. endeavor. It is a United Nations endeavor. And so they are there to convey that message. Hopefully the message will be very loud and clear, and that Saddam Hussein will abide by it. In the event that that does not take place, then obviously the United Nations has a series of things it could recommend. And we have to await for the return of the team that's currently in Baghdad to return and issue its report. And there is sufficient time to consider a whole panoply of responses that could be considered by the United Nations.
Might those include military responses?
They could include further economic measures. They could include military as well. But I think that it's important that we not speculate what those reactions might be. I think the important thing is to point out that we are united. The United Nations is united on this. This is not going to, we're not going to be able to divide the United States from the United Nations. We are there as one team, as part of the UN team, and that team cannot be divided successfully by Iraq. We're not going to negotiate. The UN is very clear on that. They're there to convey a message and not to engage in any kind of a dialogue or negotiating strategy that Saddam Hussein might have in mind. Susan.
Mr. Secretary, does this delaying tactic by Saddam put in the United States in a quandary given the absence of the surveillance flights? Would you like to see the surveillance flights begin? And also, on another issue, could you say that you agree with Secretary Albright that there is a consensus building that U.S. troops must remain in Bosnia in 98? Are you part of that consensus?
First of all, with respect to Iraq, we are not in any quandary. There's no quandary about the fact that Saddam Hussein has to comply with the UN mandates, that any removal of equipment, any effort to seek to hide in place devices or facilities in other areas will be unsuccessful, that it will only redouble the efforts on the part of the United Nations to complete those inspections, because after all, weapons of mass destruction are not in the interests of anyone in this world, and that's the reason why we're seeking to make sure that they are not being produced and in any way accelerated by Saddam Hussein. So there's no quandary for the United States. We would expect and anticipate the UN would simply redouble its efforts to make sure that those activities are not taking place. With respect to Bosnia itself, I think it's fair to say that there is a consensus that the S-4 mission will end in June, that we continue to consult with Congress and our allies about what is needed to continue the progress that we've made to date and to keep the process on track. I think as a result of this process and these consultations, there seems to be a developing consensus that some form of international military presence will be needed past June of next year, but there's been no decision made, no consensus established in terms of what form that international presence would take, whether the United States would participate in what form, be it intelligence, logistics, support, or military. That has yet to be decided or defined, and so no such consensus exists. There is a consensus, however, I think, that is shared that some form of international presence will be required beyond June of 98, but the President is trying to reach out and find out whether he can develop such a consensus, whether one exists in the United States Congress, which, of course, has imposed congressional limitations and budgetary limitations upon our presence in Bosnia, that all funding will terminate as of June of next year unless the President is able to submit a plan that would define the national security interests involved for the United States, our national interest, what that plan would entail, whether it would involve troops or other types of support, and if troops, what the size might be, what the length of stay might be, what the cost would be, what the impact on morale would be, what the impact upon readiness and also submit a request for supplemental appropriation. All of those conditions have been imposed by Congress, and so the President is reaching out to find out whether such a consensus exists within the Congress, and that was the first step that the President took this week. And I must say it was a very positive meeting. It was one of the most extraordinary exchanges of viewpoints that I have witnessed during my years in politics. I think that the country would have been very proud of the way in which the various and I would say sometimes conflicting viewpoints were presented to the President. It was truly an extraordinary meeting, and I think it was the first step to see whether a consensus can be developed that would allow some form of participation by the United States, but there was no consensus reached that evening, and I would expect it will take some time to develop such a consensus if it can be developed.
Are you going to have to eat crow on this eventually, and do you have all your consensus developed within the top brass of the military?
I have not found it in my habit of eating crow. So I don't anticipate eating crow. What I would anticipate is working with the President to find out whether or not it's in the United States' interest to continue to participate as we are today or in some form. That is not eating crow. That is promoting the U.S. Interests as defined by the President and the administration. Now, can I move on? One other question, then we get to the real substance of the meeting over here today.
But do you believe that U.S. troops will have to stay in Bosnia beyond June, you personally?
I think that's a question that is yet to be decided, and I would reserve my own judgment, my own recommendation to the President as we carry forward this process.
If I could ask one more, sir, about Iraq, and then put it to rest. Has the United States ruled out unilateral military action where you wait for the approval of the UN before any military strike is?
I think the United States, it's not in our interest to discuss what actions the United States might or might not take. This is, again, not action directed against the United States on the part of Iraq. It's action on the part of Iraq to seek to divide the United Nations. It is the United Nations which has imposed the sanctions. And so we are part of that United Nations, and we would expect the United Nations to insist upon full compliance. What takes place following these, the delivery of that message remains to be seen. I think it is not helpful to speculate what actions may or may not occur. Thank you. Please don't leave because we have an important message to deliver here this morning. Such is the life of your Secretary of Defense. Ladies and gentlemen, over the past year, NATO has been reinventing itself with prospective new members, new missions, and a new mindset for a new Europe. And I'd like to thank all of the representatives from our NATO allies who are here today helping to remake the alliance. And today we are paying tribute and honoring a defense team that is helping NATO to reinvent itself while helping the Vice President to reinvent government. And on behalf of Vice President Gore, I'd like to present our NATO Sea Sparrow Modernization Team with a Hammer Award for doing its job faster, better, and cheaper. But in presenting the Hammer Award, I also want to recognize the hundreds of DoD organizations that have earned the Hammer Awards over the past 4 years. We should be proud, and the country should be aware, that the Defense Department has won more Hammer Awards than anyone else in government. In fact, more than all of the other departments combined. We should be number one. After all, the Hammer Award was named after a defense program that came to represent what was wrong with government procurement, the $400 hammer. Today, our Hammer Awards have come to represent what is right about government procurement. And this year, as DoD celebrates its golden anniversary, our halls are ringing with the sound of countless hammers beating down the old system and building up the new one. I know that for many of you in the building, you probably thought that it was really part of Doc Cook's renovations taking place in the building, especially outside of my office, I might add. But in fact, we are building a new procurement system. And I want to applaud the NATO Sea Sparrow Modernization Team for their success. The Sea Sparrow is the Navy's premier surface-to-air missile system and a classic example of how NATO cost-sharing and technology-sharing can make defense both less expensive and also more effective. And now, thanks to this team, the Sea Sparrow Modernization Program is a living example of the National Performance Review's mantra of faster, better, cheaper. You cut the design phase by two-thirds. You made the Sparrow more reliable, more accurate. And along the way, you happened to save the taxpayers millions of dollars. The work of this team and the work of all DOD Hammer Award winners pose a challenge for everyone at the Department of Defense. It's not enough to celebrate our singular deeds. We need to accelerate our efforts to overhaul the way the department does business across the board. And our success cannot be measured out with Hammer Awards each year, like the J. Alfred Prufrock measuring out his life with coffee spoons. On the eve of World War II, Walter Lippmann issued a warning to his classmates. They had a class reunion at Harvard. I believe it was the 30th reunion. And his warning has, I think, resonance today. He said, "For every right that you cherish, you have a duty you must fulfill. For every hope that you entertain, you have a task you must perform. For every good that you wish to preserve, you must sacrifice your comfort and your ease. There is nothing for nothing any longer." The same is true for national security, national defense today. There is nothing for nothing any longer. If we want to face a world of unlimited security threats with limited resources, if we want to invest in the future force, if we want to create a 21st century Pentagon, a model of action and efficiency, then we need to apply every day what have made these winners so exceptional. We need their dedication, their innovation, and their tenacity, and their recognition that better performance is more often the result of working smarter than simply working harder. So today I am saying congratulations to Captain Taggett and his team, a talented group of people who are helping us to transform this department into the 21st century. Thank you very much.
Accepting the Hammer Award for the NATO Sea Sparrow Project Office is Captain K. James Taggett, Program Director. The Secretary will now present National Performance Review Certificates to the Capability Modernization Team members. Mr. John Bendor. Mr. Peter Browning. Dr. Ben Cantrell. Mr. Peter Browning. Ms. Willa Cornelius. Mr. Joe Colburn. Mr. John Dawson. Mr. John Dawson. Mr. Vince Dean.
In Machias. That happened to be back in 1973. I remember the walk well.
Mr. Vince Dean. Mr. Tom Dryden. Ms. Pam Franzel. Senior Chief Leon Hughes. Mr. Mike Hurt. Mr. Thoy Lee. Mr. Dave Linden. Mr. Patrick Mullaney. Mr. Fred Mayers. Ms. Barbara Ross Toski. Mr. Israel Sachs.
Don't be so quick to rush out.
Mr. Gilbert Shore. Mr. Richard Schumann. Mr. Ken Smith. Mr. Paul Sparrow. Captain K. James Taggett. Mr. Pham Thanh. Lieutenant Commander Rod Wester. And Mr. Steve Wright.
Now that's a great name to have about a hammer.
Ladies and gentlemen, this concludes our ceremony for this morning. We invite everyone to attend the reception immediately following in the NATO Sea Sparrow Project Office at 4 Crystal Park, Suite 210. Thank you for attending and have a pleasant day.
We need one more picture. Rod and a deputy, if you would.
This is their immediate leadership, Admiral Rod Grant.
Thank you, sir.
You, Dave Alway. They're sort of the folks up here.
Again, thank all of you. This is really a terrific day, and I'm proud to be able to participate in the ceremony. You've done great work, and we're the beneficiaries of it, the country and taxpayers. And I understand that we're really doing something to change the way business has been conducted in the past. So congratulations.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. It gives me pleasure today to take Mr. Bacon's place here at the podium to introduce to you Admiral Blair and General Blank, who are going to do a briefing for you on what amounts to a revolution in medical affairs to match the revolution in military affairs. Vice Admiral Dennis Blair, the Director of the Joint Staff, and Lieutenant General Ronald Blank, the Army Surgeon General, are here to brief you and give you more specifics about this transformation. The changes that they will describe in force medical protection will go a long way towards overcoming some of the health care challenges that we experienced during and after the Gulf War. Incomplete or lost medical records have made it more difficult to document complete health profiles for those who served in the Gulf. We are already seeing the benefits of new medical surveillance procedures in Bosnia, where the troops have been kept extremely healthy. The benefits of these changes will extend far beyond maintaining healthy troops during operations. The changes will mean better and more consistent care throughout a service member's career. The changes also will enable the Department of Defense to provide more complete medical histories to the Department of Veterans Affairs, our partner in providing seamless care to those who serve our country. Admiral?
Thanks, Colonel.
Yeah, good afternoon. Let me have the first slide, please, Major. As many of you know, Joint Vision 2010 is our concept for talking about how we're going to fight different in the future from the way we're fighting now. One of the key tenets within Joint Vision 2010 is full dimensional protection, taking care of our people so that they can do their job. Within that, force medical protection is a key aspect that I'd like to talk about this afternoon. Now, to have a vision, to do things in a different way, you really need a unifying picture of where we're going. And let me show you in this next slide what our unifying picture is for force medical protection. I don't think it's being too facetious to say that if we had an old vision for what force medical protection was during a war, during a deployment, it would be something like the movie MASH. Soldiers go out, get shot, come back, get fixed, patched up, put them back in the fight. In this new world that we're in now, since the end of the Cold War, we need an entirely new vision, and this is it. It takes one of our soldiers, takes him and her all the way from the time that they come into the force through the time that they're training up, that they're in the force, and then they go off on a deployment, and it's a whole new set of considerations with specific things we have to do along the way in these far distant parts of the world where we are increasingly deploying our forces for operations. And a particular service person may go 2, 3, 4 times through this cycle through the course of his or her career. And it emphasizes, as the logo down on the right shows, protection and monitoring as a proactive, get ahead of it way to do it, rather than simply taking care of them, health care, which is only a part of it. We've really formed around this concept within OSD, within the joint staff, the SINCs, and the services as a better way of doing business in order to have a much healthier force. Now, to carry out any vision, there are a bunch of major muscle movements in an organization like the Department of Defense with 2.5 million people, and let me show you some of those in the next slide. Starting at the top, the Secretary puts out his directives and his instructions, and two very important ones are shown here in terms of really emphasizing the surveillance aspects of our deployments. Secretary does policy. Chairman, whom I work for, does doctrine. And our two big doctrine pubs, 402 and 502, are in the process of being completely rewritten under this new vision that I showed you earlier. In the planning area, our defense planning guidance, where we relate resources to mission, there's strong guidance there on how we get this new vision implemented. In our JSCAP, each of our theater plans has an annex, Annex Quebec, completely rewritten, which emphasizes this proactive medical approach. Before I talk about execution, this Joint Health Service Support Strategy, this is kind of a top-down approach, policy, doctrine, and so on. In order to jumpstart this vision, my medical team on the joint staff has put together 11 seminars in the key areas that are unique to this vision. We're getting in everybody in these seminars, folks from headquarters, medics from the commands, and really jumpstarting this whole process across the board in order to get the word out faster. And let me emphasize about three things in the operational side. SINC emphasis. I'm personally aware that over the past year, I can think of SINCure putting out very detailed guidance on these non-combatant evacuation operations, which we've been conducting with increasing frequency in the European theater from Albania down through Western Africa. SINC sent. I recall the guidance that SINC put out in terms of medical force protection as we moved our forces in desert focus to after the Khobar Towers attack. Medical surveillance is also a key difference. We're understanding a lot more about these areas of the world that we're deploying to that have diseases that you and I can't even pronounce, much less spell, and we have to do operations there. And finally, information system technology, a little bit of which General Blank is going to show you here shortly, which we're putting into these new operations in order to be able to keep better track of what we're doing. Let me go back to that previous slide and talk to you in more concrete terms about what we've been doing in Bosnia, which is the largest deployment we've had since Desert Storm. Starting out where that curve takes off from the stays off from a straight line in pre-deployment. We've done a much more thorough job of health surveys, immunization reviews, taken serum samples from our people, so we have a good baseline of what they were like when they went into the theater. A lot of education to them so they know what to expect. And as I mentioned, environmental analysis ahead of time, so we knew what was going on in that part of the world. And let me emphasize, this is a total force program. A lot of reservists are out there in Bosnia, and they were prepared medically the same way as we did our active forces. In the deployment and operations cycle, we had a lot of teams forward, preventive medicine teams doing oil and doing soil and air sampling, forward deployed laboratories which can do really high grade medical laboratory research right there on the spot rather than having to send this stuff all the way back to the States. And finally, a lot of mental health stress teams out there, both taking surveys to determine how people are doing and giving individual counseling as we went. And finally, as people came out of the deployments, and we've rotated over twice now, taking another good baseline so that we know how they are as they come out, can compare it to how they were when they went in, and have a good picture of what was happening to our folks over there. And the results have been good. Our disease and non-battle injuries in Bosnia are setting new records in terms of success, better than the Gulf War, which is better than all of the operations previously. We're basically setting this high bar higher and higher for our medical folks, and they're responding by clearing it time after time. Now, all wasn't perfect in Bosnia, and all is not going to be perfect in any operation that we do in the armed forces. But what I see as an operator is that we're learning from each of our deployments, and we've done about 40 of them since Desert Storm, from then to now, 40 major ones. Each time we're plowing the lessons back in, making it better, and making it healthier for our people. So let me just summarize what I see from where I sit with working for the chairman, working a lot with the SINCs and the services. It's got military leadership emphasis on it. People are thinking about force medical protection more than we have been in the past. We're learning as we go. This is a work in progress. If I brief you in a year, it'll be better than it is now. It's better now than it was a year ago. And there's been basically a sea change in the way we think about this. More proactive, more of a cycle, less of a send them out and patch them up mentality than we had in the past. And the medical establishment in coordination with the line officers are going out and making this thing happen. That's what I see from where I sit, but we've got some of the pros here, and let me turn it over to General Ron Blank, the Army Surgeon General, who will tell us in particular about some of the technology that's enabling us to do this a lot better. Ron?
Good afternoon. We learned a number of lessons from the Persian Gulf War, and that experience, and the follow-up from it. Two of the major ones was that we needed to do better environmental surveillance, and that we needed something better than the same paper record that we have used in deployments since World War I. We needed something like this. And this could be my medical record. You see it, I have it on a chain, wear around my neck. This is one of five competing systems that we're currently testing that holds immunization data, that holds all of the health events that occur in a deployment or back in garrison, that hold images, x-rays, even video if applicable. And this kind of thing is a way that we will assure consistent record keeping, storage, and then the ability to retrieve data whenever we need it that we've not had up till now. First slide. As has been stated, Bosnia has been the most successful from a health standpoint deployment that we've ever had. I'm fond of saying that I know more about the air, soil, and water of Bosnia than I do about Fort Indiantown Gap or Quantico, Virginia, and it's true because we've really looked. We've done 112,000 analyses of all of those aspects. We have a laboratory in theater to do that and to serve as a reference laboratory. We've actually made changes based on what we've seen. As we did for other deployments, of course, we also did disease surveillance, and on the basis of that, we made vaccines available with informed consent to our troops to protect against tick-borne encephalitis, and in fact, we've had no cases of tick-borne encephalitis. Next slide, please. It has led to us, again, it's already been stated, but let me point it out, the lowest disease non-battle injury rate of any deployment. We just don't see the kinds of problems that we saw in previous conflicts. And in fact, if you compare this to the disease non-battle injury rate at Fort Bragg or at San Diego, it's less than that. It's actually, you could make the argument, healthier to be in Bosnia. Now, of course, we screen the people before they go there, so they have a certain baseline. That might not be the case at other places. Next slide. But what I'd like to do, really, is to show you, give you a demonstration of what I consider the biggest advance to come out of all of this, and that's this. We don't have it yet in Bosnia. We're still relying on paper records, but it's where we're going. And we're working this very, very hard within DOD and with the VA so that we have that consistent, comprehensive, automated record available that has a large storage capacity. And this is megabytes. We're going to be up into gigabytes in the not-too-distant future. This is very, very durable. You have to have technology that folks can use in the field that can withstand the extremes of cold and heat, go through mud and all of the kinds of things that soldiers, sailors, airmen, and Marines are faced with and still be able to be used. And in fact, this fits in a sleeve such as this along with the tag of a personal information carrier of a provider. You have to have both of them to use. It fits in the disk drive of a personal computer. And now we're going to show you what you can do with it. Dr. Paul Zimnick is one of the testers up at the Medical Research Material Command. And what we have here is a theoretical record on Staff Sergeant Edward Martin. You see Social Security number, rather, and other demographic data, allergies, current medications. And then at the bottom, and go ahead and scroll up if you would, you see a vaccination history. Not only can we put down and capture and store all of the immunizations, but it also is the basis for us knowing when to give further immunizations, when a booster is necessary, when anything else needs to be done. Scroll up again. The next is the, scroll down, I beg your pardon. Next is the NATO field medical card. This is a standardized form that all the NATO countries use that have standardized information. Usually they're done in both English and French as kind of the languages that we've agreed upon. And they have standard descriptions of problems, injuries, and level of consciousness. Let's just pull down the menu. So for problem, you see it's none, trauma, disease, psychiatric. We'll leave disease on. Let's go to injury. Amputation is on, but it could be head, wound, neck back injury, just leave it on back injury. So that goes there. Level of consciousness, the same kind of thing. We'll leave it on unresponsive. And then pulse, whether or not a tourniquet was used, whether or not morphine was given. That's pretty basic information. It is standardized. But then there's also a space for adding any other information. We've put in injured in a vehicle accident, trapped in the vehicle for 1 hour, so you know that something is going on. There's shock, there's exposure, airway clear, no apparent fractures, and transferring and so forth. Now, the interesting thing is that this can be added by the medic or by the care provider, physician's assistant, physician, at the battalion aid station or at the clinic or in the emergency room, conceivably even by the ambulance, and it can be sent to the next level of care through whatever communication pipeline you have, whether it's radio or other methods of communicating, by email. Paul, if you go ahead and send that. The data on this tag is encrypted, and it's sent in an encrypted format as well, which is significant. So now, from the battalion aid station or the forward surgical team, we've sent this to the combat support hospital where they have this ready. But it's not only the data. It's not only the pulse and the blood pressure, the other data that you see here. We can also send images. And so if you go to the X-ray, it doesn't show up very well with the lights on it. But these X-rays or other images are of good enough quality to be read to show the information that there might be a pneumothorax or there might be some other kind of injury or illness going on, that preparation can be made. We can even, if we have large enough capacity, and we're beginning to on these, have the ability to put audio and video on this, all on this little tag. And it can be read, as I say, in a standard personal computer just with these sleeves. So we think this is really in advance and will allow us to continue to provide quality health care, but do it at the leading edge of technology, using our information and automation system in ways that will really support the deployments of tomorrow. Thank you very much. And at this point, I think we'll open for any questions that you might have. I know that we're to be followed by the regular press brief.
These tags to be in use? I mean, what is the timeline for?
Right. We've already prototype tested these. Dr. Zimnick over here, he has done this up at Fort Detrick, and we've done it down at Fort Gordon, so we know that they can be used and can withstand all the temperature and so forth. We're now going to test them in a more extended fashion at a small post or base in 1998, and given that all of the systems work as we expect, we believe we will be able to begin deploying these sometime in 1999.
What about the privacy of a record? Aren't you creating an environment, even though this seems very good, that lots of people will be able to have access to someone's record?
Yeah, I think there's two concerns here. One is, what do you put on the record that you wouldn't want someone else to have, and then how secure can you make it? So we're developing policies of what you really put on here, and very, very sensitive data we would not put on here. On the other hand, data that would be of use to other providers, clearly we want to put on here. Having it in the encrypted format that I've briefly touched upon will help, and it won't be easy to get access to it. And also having the requirement for both the patient record but also a provider tag such as this to be used in the sleeve will also make it more difficult. That is, you have to have both. You just can't find this laying in the street, go to your PC, even if you have a sleeve, and use it. You have to have something that allows for the reading of it.
And let me just say, if you know, from the truth point of view, if I'm lying there bleeding after some situation, I have one of these things with me that the person who's treating me can tell right away exactly what my blood type is and what's been done to me in the past and what's there. I'd rather have that information right there than having the guy guessing. So I think the key thing is getting that tag and erring on the side of having the information that makes the medical treatment right and swift and quick there. So we're not real hung up. We have to worry about the privacy thing, but we're concerned about having the information there so that the care can be given so we can save troops.
Do you envision that dependents would have one of these as well, or just the service member?
Oh, at some point, I think all of our patients will have them.
What's the cost of one of these chips, and what are you expecting to spend to implement this system?
Great question. Right now, they cost us about $10, maybe a little bit more, because they're early prototypes. Actually, they cost 75 cents. 75 cents. So when we begin getting to where the technology is taking us, have the high capacity and get them in volume, they're going to be very inexpensive. But of course, the cost is far more than this chip. It's also the sleeves that you need. These cost $130 actually, which is not a whole lot. And then you have to do the kinds of things that ensure the connectivity of other systems, the digitization of images, et cetera, so there's going to be costs in this that we're only beginning to realize. But actually, I think this can be done very cost-effectively. And what you just saw as using email, it's actually part of Netscape, to send this information allows all sorts of connections and integrations with telemedicine that weren't before possible without a lot of software adjustment and all of that. It appears that that's not going to be nearly as important or necessary as we thought.
It's interesting about records. You have three records if you're in the armed forces, for those of you who have served: your pay record, your personnel record, and your health record. Let's hold a quiz here. Which record do you think is the best maintained of all of those three? Pay record, right? Every 2 weeks. You check in. If it's not right, you're in there figuring out what it is. Next, personnel record. You get promoted every 4 or 5 years, whatever, in this outfit. You want to make sure that that's right. This record is one that we have the hardest time getting people to maintain right, because it's not self-correcting. There's not a lot of impetus there on the part of the person to to do it. When I was a CO on a ship, I've spent, my corpsman spent about a quarter of his time taking care of patients, and he did that very well. The other 90% of his time, because he worked about 110%, was making sure that these things are up to date, because there's not a self-correcting mechanism there that where people want it to be right. So this stuff is really important, because we can get the information on the card right away, so that the person right at the point of application will know about it, and we can pump it back so that it's maintained in a good record file that we can get our hands on and do the sorts of work that it's being required of us these days to know what's happened in the force as a whole. So we're fighting human nature here. Human nature doesn't want to do this. This will help us beat human nature, get the information where we can get to it, and we can do the right thing by our people, whether they know it or not.
Our first concern, obviously, is quality of care, but think of the cost savings if you have this. Just because you don't have to repeat the chest x-ray that you lost, nobody can find, or was done in the last hospital you were at and you didn't take it with you. And that, by the way, is true of civilian as well as military medicine, or the CBC, the complete blood count that doesn't have to be redone, or the on and on the examples go, the lab test that was lost and so forth and so on. This really assures that. So it's a quality issue first and foremost. And then, although it'll cost to implement, there's going to be enormous savings.
Time for one more question. Can you give us, just in terms that a lot of us who are not very good with computers will understand, what is the storage power on one of those chips? How many K are we talking about?
Well, this is actually, I think, truth in lending, 10 megabytes. The ones that we're starting to test up at Dietrich are 20 megabytes. Next year or so, we'll have 256 megabytes. So we're now talking 40,000 pages. Now, it's less if you put images, because that takes up a lot of storage capacity, pages potentially of medical records. And in our lifetime, and I mean in the next 2, 3, 4 years, something like that, we'll be up in the gigabyte range as we transition from storing data with electrons to light, packets of light. And then you get into the real big storage kinds of capacity. And that clearly is what we're moving towards.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
There will be a 10-minute filing break. About 10 after 2 will be regular briefing. We'll start. Anybody wants to see them, here they are.
Well, welcome to our third event of the day. I don't have any special graphics for you. I'd like to start by welcoming some visitors. We have a Lieutenant Colonel here from Slovakia, and two gentlemen from Albania who are here as part of a USIA-sponsored visitor program. Welcome. Second, I'd like to announce what most of you already know, that on Wednesday, Secretary Cohen will be leaving for a 12-day trip to Asia. It will take him to the Republic of Korea, China, Malaysia, Singapore, Indonesia, and Japan between November 12th and November 23rd. And tomorrow, in this room at 11 a.m., we will have a background briefing on the trip that will lay out not only a more precise itinerary, but talk to you about some of the themes of the trip as well. And with that, I'll take your questions. Charlie.
Ken, do you expect, without letting too much out of the bag, when he's in China, that Secretary Cohen will come to any agreements on further military-to-military relations with the Chinese? Is that expected?
Four military-to-military agreements were discussed in Washington when President Jiang was here with President Clinton. And also, Secretary Cohen met privately with President Jiang to follow up on some of these discussions. During that summit meeting, we came to a general agreement on the maritime rules of the road agreement, and that will be formally signed in China. And we hope to move closer together on some of the details of the other topics we discussed here last week, One of those deals with humanitarian relief and disaster assistance, how China and the U.S. can work together in those areas. We also have a schedule of exchanges for next year, 1998, military-to-military exchanges. I think that will be formalized. So I would anticipate more work on these agreements, finalization of these agreements. I don't anticipate there'll be other new agreements at this time, but that's something that will certainly come up tomorrow if you want to pursue it further. Suzanne.
The Secretary this morning spoke of the possibility of both a potential for economic steps against Iraq, also held out the option of military. On the economic side, what leverage does the UN have? Is it possible, speaking of removing this oil for food program, what?
Well, first of all, it's a decision for the UN to make, but clearly the oil for food program was allowed recently by the UN, and presumably it could be disallowed by the UN. But that's a decision that the Security Council will have to make. And when the current delegation comes back from Iraq and Iraqi officials speak to the UN on Monday, then the Security Council will sit down and look at all the facts. And obviously the most important fact is going to be whether Iraq has shown any sign that it intends to comply with the UN Security Council resolutions. And after it looks at all the facts, based on the visit and other information they can gather, the behavior of the Iraqi officials in Iraq, the way they're, whether they've ended the cavalier treatment that they're inflicting on the UNSCOM team now, they'll decide what to do next.
Has the final decision been made on the whether or not the Nimitz will make its previously scheduled port call, and what, if any, message should Saddam Hussein draw from that regarding whether possibility or probability of military action?
Well, first of all, the Nimitz had a planned a port call in its long-range schedule. That port call was scheduled for this weekend, and it has been delayed. Changes in operations take place from time to time, and I don't think we're trying to send any signal right now to Saddam Hussein, except he ought to comply with the UN mandates, and it's the UN that is sending that signal by through its team in Iraq, and also through the statements that are coming out of New York.
Doesn't this show that the United States wants to maintain its maximum firepower around Iraq at this time?
We have a significant force in the Gulf. As you know, about 18,000 people are there now, 17 ships, I believe, about 205 combat airplanes. It's a significant force. It's a ready force, and Saddam Hussein knows that. It's been operating in the Gulf for a good number of years. Yes, Bill.
Yes, this taking away of the UN site by threatening the U-2 flights, by taking the cameras out, by basically trying to get the U.S. out of it, to what avail
profit Mr. Saddam Hussein? And can the U.S. or UN cover the bases insofar as possible movements or tampering by Iraq of weapons sites?
I'm sorry, what was the second part of the question?
The second part is, can the U.S. or the UN, is there other eyes, is there a vision?
Find other ways.
For finding other ways to see what he's doing.
Well, I think it's pretty clear what Saddam Hussein is up to. He is trying to make it difficult or impossible for the UN to do its work. He's trying to make it impossible for the UN to enforce the Security Council resolutions that have been passed since the 1991 war. The world is unified in the feeling, or the world is expressed through the UN, is unified in the feeling that it will be dangerous to stability in the region if Saddam Hussein rekindles his programs to build weapons of mass destruction. We believe that most of the nuclear weapons infrastructure, the machinery to build nuclear weapons that he was trying to put together, has been dismantled and eliminated. The UN organizations have checked that, the IAEA, and that's their conclusion. UNSCOM, the UN Special Commission, that's been looking at three other areas, missiles, chemical weapons, and biological weapons, has concluded that it has accounted for the overwhelming percentage of Iraq's imported Scud missiles. And UNSCOM believes that it knows what that capability is, and that it's that it has been taken care of. There is some evidence that that Iraq is trying to maintain the ability to start up an indigenous Scud production line should sanctions be lifted, and it's able to acquire machinery, equipment, and parts on the world market, which, of course, it isn't now. So these sanctions are valuable in that they do prevent Iraq from developing its weapons of mass destruction programs, the UN sanctions. In terms of chemical weapons, UNSCOM believes that Iraq probably may have a very small stockpile of chemical agents or munitions or production facilities left over from the Gulf War. You know that Iraq has used chemical weapons in the past, we have to assume would be willing under certain circumstances to use them in the future. Iraq may have an indigenous capability to manufacture some nerve gas, some gases such as mustard, maybe sarin. This could start up if there weren't proper monitoring of Iraq's production facilities. A lot of the facilities are dual-use facilities now. In the biological area, before the war, Iraq produced huge quantities of botulinum toxin as well as anthrax. They claimed to have loaded these toxins onto Scud missiles and into bombs before the war. They have also admitted conducting research on mycotoxins and infectious viruses. This has after the war. They admitted this after the war. They claimed 2 years ago to have destroyed all of these agents from the Gulf War, but have not yet produced any evidence to back up this claim. And one of the things that UNSCOM is trying to do is to look at the scope of their biological weapons capability. That, again, is one of the things that's being blocked by the obstructionist approach that Iraq is taking now. So this is serious business.
How impacted is the UN's mission to monitor by not having inspectors, 24-hour cameras, and YouTube lights?
It is badly impacted, and it's a real setback to the forces in the world community that that want to prevent Iraq from developing new weapons of mass destruction, or who want to follow through with full compliance to the UN mandates that they eliminate all of their weapons of mass destruction capability. We cannot be certain without the types of inspections and other monitoring that UNSCOM has been doing very diligently until now. Yes.
Can I have two questions on news reports out of Turkey? There was one that said that, quoting a Turkish government official, says the U.S. has requested the use of Incirlik to stage possible air raids, if that should be approved. Can you comment on that?
I don't believe that's true.
Okay, and the other one was news reports quoted unnamed U.S. officials as saying that 10 more fighter aircraft have been moved to Incirlik, but not in response to the Iraq situation.
Well, that's not entirely true either, but let me explain what's happened there, because something has happened. Back in October, when Iraq started violating the southern and the northern no-fly zone, we in the south improved changed our operations to fly further north inside the no-fly zone. We started flying more robust patrols as part of Southern Watch, and of course the Nimitz arrived in the area, so we heavied up our patrols and our operations in the area. In response to that, Iraq ceased violations in the southern no-fly zone. In the northern no-fly zone, we have a more restrained operation because there are fewer numbers of U.S. planes up in the north, and the flights are made by the U.S. In a rotation with Turkish operations, so there's a deconfliction, and we don't fly every day. And when we do fly, we are not in the so-called box, the no-fly zone, from dawn till dusk, as we are now in the south. That's one of the things we started doing in the south in early October, was flying pretty much from dawn till dusk. Now, the Iraqi Air Force is largely a daylight air force. We can fly 24 hours a day. It does not pay us to do that because the Iraqi Air Force largely flies only during daylight hours. One of the things we started looking at in the north was how can we achieve a more robust operation in the north similar to what we've done in the south. And one of the things we've done is to add some additional fighters, F-16s. Four additional fighters have recently arrived. They're flying out of Incirlik. And one additional tanker has also arrived to support them. So our hope is that we'll be able to spend more time flying in the northern no-fly zone in order to make our patrols more thorough. Suzanne. Just let me say, this has nothing to do with the current dispute between Iraq and the UN. This plan was made prior to this dispute over inspections. And it took us a while to get the planes there, but it is really a separate issue from the dispute between the UN and Iraq.
Do you happen to know if they deployed out of Europe those additional aircraft to the States? Do you know?
I can find out.
Yes.
Europe, out of Europe. Suzanne.
I just wanted to follow up on the other the aircraft carrier. There was a port call by the George Washington in the Med. Did that go according to schedule, continue? Any changes there?
It is currently in port in Haifa, and that port call is scheduled to end in several days, and the USS George Washington is scheduled to return to operations in the central Mediterranean Sea.
Just to clarify, James. The question about permission to use Incirlik for possible offensive strikes. You're saying that no such request was made?
That's my understanding.
Was the Turkish Prime Minister mistaken then when he was quoted as saying that that they had received such a request?
I will check further on this. It's my understanding, based on what I was told, that that there has not been such a request.
Richard Butler of the UN has said that he has requested a Monday U-2 flight. Have you begun any of your notification process or planning for such a mission?
I'm not aware that we have, but that doesn't mean we haven't, because I just haven't checked on that. I know that the President said 2 days ago that we plan to resume flights, and so I have to assume that we'll take all steps necessary to do that. As you know, or maybe you don't, but the fact is that when we notify, when UNSCOM notifies Iraq that a U-2 was going to fly over central Iraq, it gives them a 48-hour window. So there's some flexibility as to when the plane actually flies.
Are you confident that the United States can protect that plane in case Saddam follows through on his threat?
I'm confident that these planes are well suited to. They have all the latest technology that they can have to protect themselves.
Can the U-2 work photograph at an altitude that is above range of surface-to-air capability?
Well, of course, there are all types of surface-to-air missiles, and some can go higher than the U-2. Most go lower than the U-2 flies.
But I'm talking about what Iraq has.
Without getting into operational details, one can never be certain when it comes to military operations, but what we try to do is reduce risk as much as possible, and that's how we've designed the U-2.
Would there be any sort of extra protection for the planes in terms of combat air patrol?
I don't think it profits me to talk about future operations.
But without specifying, can you say if any extra measures will be taken to ensure the safety of the planes?
I've tried to tell you that the plane has the latest technology for self-protection, and I think I'll leave it at that. Yes, Steve.
Given the threat, are you rethinking the notification of Iraq?
Well, of course, this is done under arrangements worked out between the UN and Iraq. And actually, the notification is designed to protect the plane in order to let them know when it's okay for a plane to fly over their territory, when they can expect a plane to fly over. And so I think the notification is a self-protective measure to a large extent.
Before they threaten to start shooting them down. And now, given that threat, you're going to tell them when a U-2 is going to fly over the country?
Well, as I said, it's a window. And this is not the type of operational detail I want to talk about. But I'm not aware that there has been any thought by the UN, but you should ask them. To changing the notification procedures. Charlie.
And regarding Jamie's early question on the Nimitz, you said that you weren't trying to send any special message to Iraq. You're not saying that this delay is not connected to the current situation, are you?
The commander-in-chief of the Central Command, General Zinni, like any sink, always has to evaluate the deployment of his assets in light of current situations. The Nimitz has been steaming around in the Gulf for about a month, and it will continue to be in the Gulf for, along with a number of other U.S. ships, for the next several months. I'm not reading a lot into this. You or other people want to draw conclusions, you're free to do that. I'm not going to characterize it in any way.
So are you saying that is this in light of the current situation or not?
I'm saying that he didn't think it was appropriate at this time for the USS Nimitz to make a port call, and I don't choose to say anything more about General Zinni's decision.
Have any other ship schedules been affected? Any other Tomahawk shooters being sortied into the Gulf? Into General Zinni's command?
We have I don't believe directed any new assets recently into the Gulf. We maintain a substantial naval presence in the Gulf with a considerable range of capabilities on a day-to-day basis.
Just to clarify on the U-2 flight, are you confirming that in fact there was a U-2 flight scheduled for Monday?
I'm not confirming it. I'm telling you that there's a notification procedure that sets it. The question I was asked referred to a statement by Mr. Butler. I responded by talking about a notification procedure and something the President had said. I don't think I repeated the idea that the flight was going to occur on Monday.
I just want to clarify that. I wanted to make sure
I'm glad you did. I'm glad you did. I thought that I'd been sufficiently opaque to sort of wipe out clarity in this case, but you've helped me clarify the opacity of the statement. Yes, Suzanne.
Different subject.
Sure. Can you describe for us any military actions on the ground in observing Iraqi forces in any way? Are they doing anything unusual during this period, like dispersing?
Have some evidence of dispersal by some Iraqi units in the last few days.
Now, what does that mean to the Defense Department? Does that mean they're getting ready to go to war and do a big strike? Does that mean that they're anticipating a strike?
There's always debate over how to evaluate movements by foreign troops, but I think most analysts would say that dispersion is a defensive measure.
Are we talking ground forces here? Are we talking them hiding parts of their air force in different parts of the country?
This is a defensive measure.
Primarily ground forces, but it's applied to other forces as well.
Have they painted any U.S. aircraft or done anything like that with their ground-based radars?
Not that I'm aware of.
Have any units beyond the ones that are in the region already been put on alert or told to stand by for possible?
Not that I'm aware of.
Could you go further into the dispersal of forces?
No.
Would you call these large numbers of troops? Or?
I think I've said enough.
Iraq says that dispersal is because it's preparing for an attack by the United States. Is the United States preparing to attack?
Gee, Jamie, I would really like to be able to give you details on future plans, but I just don't think I'll do it today. This is a diplomatic dispute between Iraq and the UN, and we're trying to solve this as a member of the Security Council diplomatically. We think that Saddam's actions make it very clear to the world that he is not interested in playing by the rules of the road. We think it makes it very clear to the world that he wants to increase tensions when the rest of the world wants to decrease tensions, and we hope that he will listen to the UN team that's currently over there talking to him about the need to comply with UN resolutions.
On the floor of the Senate, Senator Thurman evidently said today that there seems to be an agreement that the President will not veto the defense bill. Has Secretary Cohen given the Senator some assurance that there's an agreement worked out on the depot issue, for example?
The Secretary talks to Senators on a regular basis, and what he's been telling them is that the President and the Administration continue to look at the bill, study the bill, and we're, as an Administration, continuing efforts to get a bill that will satisfy the Administration. But I think it's we're still trying to work to get the best possible bill.
So it isn't entirely satisfactory yet, is what you're saying?
Well, no bill is 100% satisfactory. That's part of the democratic system. They're all built on compromises, and this one could be characterized as containing some compromises. The question is, are the compromises the best possible compromises for the country, and do they advance the administration's goals? And the administration is still looking at that. No, as I said, no decision has been made on that yet.
Back on China for a second. Are you saying that there's no agreement to sign a military technical cooperation agreement, one of those four, like the old Peace Pearl program, where we help to modernize fighter aircraft?
I'm saying there is no such agreement. And that was not brought up during the summit, to the best of my knowledge, and I don't believe it'll be discussed during Secretary Cohen's visit either.
Just to get back to the authorization bill, has there been any kind of written exchange, any thing that the Secretary may have sent to Senator Thurman indicating what the administration would find acceptable?
I don't know exactly what Senator Thurman said. I think that The Secretary and Senator Thurman and the White House are all united in hoping that that we can get a bill everybody can agree to. But I think I'll just leave it at that. The bill has is still under consideration.
Thank you.
Ken, you were quoted in the Post today as saying that Secretary Cohen now believes that U.S. troops will have to stay in Bosnia after June of 98. Were you accurately quoted?
I think the Secretary spoke very clearly on that earlier today when he talked about what's going on, and that is there is a developing consensus that there will be a continuing international military presence in Bosnia after June of 1998 to build on the progress that we've achieved in the last 24 months. The President has not yet decided what form the U.S. participation will take, and he's begun active consultations with Congress and with the allies to reach that decision, but there has been no decision on the President's part yet. Bill.
Just one more briefly. On a hearing yesterday with General Lyles and Kurt Weldon, Mr. Weldon says there's a window of vulnerability in Israel for the missile defense, and also probably would be applied to Korea. There was also an unfortunate exchange. Ken, can you respond to this, this window of vulnerability, not having an anti-missile defense, and Iran coming on strong with a missile offense?
Well, first of all, we do have missile defense systems. The issue is what are we going to develop in the future to improve our missile defenses, and how quickly can we do that? We have a fairly aggressive program to improve our theater missile defenses precisely because we're worried about development programs in countries such as Iran. Unfortunately, some of these programs basically involve developing technology where one bullet hits another bullet, both of which are going at extremely fast rates of speed. It's a daunting technological challenge, and we've had some problems in the THAAD program, the Theater High Altitude program that's being worked on now. We continue to work on that, and hope that we have a considerable experience in solving difficult technological problems. One of the things we've learned from that experience is that they sometimes take time and they take money. We're spending the money, and we're spending it as rapidly as we think we effectively can at this stage without wasting it. In terms of the threat, we do know that Iran is working aggressively to develop longer-range missiles. We are very concerned about this. We've made our concerns clear. We've discussed this with a number of other countries, including Russia and China and our European allies. We certainly discussed it during the recent visit here by Defense Minister Mordecai of Israel. Secretary Cohen and Minister Mordecai discussed it. And we are continuing to work basically on two tracks to deal with these emerging potential threats. The first is to develop a more robust theater ballistic missile defense systems, and the second is to try to slow down or stop a rogue country such as Iran from increasing their ballistic missile capability.
Was Weldon correct in quoting an intelligence report that said Iran could field one of these missiles capable of striking anywhere in the Gulf within the next 24 months?
I don't feel comfortable about discussing intelligence reports, even if they've been discussed by members of Congress.
He said, basically, I think both he and the general agreed that 2 months ago they learned of this increased threat by Iran of a medium-range missile. Does that ring a bell?
We are aware that Iran is working on programs to develop longer-range missiles, and we're doing our best to try to slow or halt those programs.
One last question on Iraq. You say that there's some evidence of troop dispersion. Has there also been evidence of heightened activity around their missile batteries and sites?
Well, first of all, Iraq itself has said that they're dispersing troops. So that's one piece of evidence we have, is Iraq's own statement about what they're doing with their own military. Frequently, let me just talk about patterns, past patterns. In the past, when Iraq has dispersed its forces because it is fearful of some action against it, it's dispersed more than its ground forces. It's dispersed its missile forces as well. It tends to move them around on a fairly regular basis. Its surface-to-air missile sites are sometimes moved around.
As I got you on the subject, doesn't the United States share, or at least have the capability of sharing with the UN, satellite data that would preclude the effectiveness of what Saddam has done about taking the eyes away, the sight away from the UN?
Well, we certainly watch very closely what UNSCOM picks up in its efforts, and I don't think there's any replacement for on-the-ground inspections that allows us to allows the UN to and the civilized West, the civilized world interested in stopping growth of weapons of mass destruction. There's no substitute for actually getting into buildings where they may be actually working on biological or chemical warfare projects. You can do a lot with airplanes, and you can do a lot with cameras, but you need real eyeball-to-eyeball studies in some cases, and that's why it's absolutely crucial that that the UNSCOM inspectors be allowed to continue with their work. Thanks.
Thank you, sir.